morning, family and friends, on this lovely Sunday. Before I begin my brief introduction, please turn off your cell phones and other electronic devices now. And please refrain from using any recording devices from this point forward to the conclusion of the teaching today. Only Sakya authorized media will be recording today. Thank you for your understanding and cooperation in this matter. On behalf of His Holiness Jigdal Dakshin Sakya, Head Lama of the Pusuk Podram, of the 940-year-old Sakya Kon lineage of Tibetan Buddhism, and the founder of this first Sakya Monastery of Tibetan Buddhism in North America, I welcome you to Sakya Monastery this auspicious third day of April 2016. I thank His Holiness Jigdal Dakshin Sakya for creating this beautiful traditional Tibetan Buddhist sanctuary where we can freely and safely practice the Holy Dharma for the benefit of all sentient beings. I thank the Holy Sangha for their exemplary ethical conduct and their profound contemplation and meditation on the teachings of Lord Buddha. I especially want to extend a warm welcome and our heartfelt gratitude to His Holiness Sakya Trizin, Head Lama of the Dharma Podrang of the Sakya Kon lineage of Tibetan Buddhism, for traveling a great distance from his home in India to kindly offer the Seattle Sakya Sangha three magnificent treasures of the Sakya Dharma tradition. Yesterday, His Holiness Sakya Trizin led our Sangha in the Dharma Protector Mahakala Puja. Today, His Holiness is offering us the teaching of Chogyal Phagpa's advice of the Precious Jewel Garland. And tomorrow, His Holiness will be offering a denshu ceremony and long life prayers to benefit his dear beloved Dharma brother, His Holiness Jigdal Dakshin Sakya. On this momentous and meritorious occasion of His Holiness Sakya Trizin's visit to Seattle, His Holiness is nurturing the opening of the exquisite lotus flower of enlightenment, revealing the sweet nectar of the Buddha Dharma, and inspiring us to continue diligently and patiently to practice the Holy Dharma for the benefit of all sentient beings. I thank His Holiness Sakya Trizin and His Holiness Jigdal Dakshin Sakya for embodying and manifesting the body, speech, mind, qualities, and activities of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, and for modeling the six perfections and four immeasurables for the benefit of all sentient beings. I thank His Holiness Sakya Trizin and His Holiness Jigdal Dakshin Sakya for generating the fruitful and sustainable harmony among the Sakya Kon lineage and among the greater Sakya community worldwide. And I thank His Holiness Sakya Trizin and His Holiness Jigdal Dakshin Sakya for completely and fearlessly dedicating their long lives to the ultimate enlightenment of all sentient beings. In this assembly of brilliant and dazzling Sakya masters and other great Dharma practitioners, I am filled with awe, wonder, and joy. Long live the Sakya Kon lineage of Tibetan Buddhism. May this holy lineage continue for the next millennium, offering to all beings suffering in samsara the healing wisdom and powerful benefits of the Buddha Dharma. Thank you.
Pandan zawe lama rambo je dage jo be men den jo kadro en be gon en je zon ko zo de jo ge do za do zo kon ga do je maro en ja bo en ya ma zon e yo go ni je Yema langa rage do moinda, todo onjoinda langa janzai, tuje jembo donden, tado yenje denzem, Nanjo Mojo Zajamba Konga Nimbo Lajanza Senam Bame Lindu Yin Chenbe Yehye Rajim Dove Zalan Chujim Senam Zemma Lajanza Chinna Gunja Denyez Sanga Janzen Baruj Dojen Zemba Gunja Taba janze la janze, hija damje zibye jayam, drogo gilin drubye dujin, sayin drulin zibye dungav, jange lami jalan gijanze, tade gundo zambye namban, zimye dindo damje jimbad, Zalwe denbien dabo ngazo, Chijam babi jala sovandin, Dojo gunji janzo lishan, Sanga yishi nubi gadinji, Pende banjo zambo tsundzim, Pade lami jala sovandin, Shani gundi lama rumbo, Trishin chiji jila sovan, Yomi garin jinji dujiz, Dushu badu gundu shinjilu, Shiva gundu yamda lama, Dami chiji bala longshij, Sada longshu yindi radzun, Doji jangi gombo yudu yu, Sajo biju shuji medon, Rara liju nidi jimbon, Samje shindi mindi bovay, Drogi nomda yindu jimbo yu, Sunje nomje somba, Yenshi dai jidav, Chijay tumon dibayi, Chijay koloi godu zo.
So today here, the respected Dungse Rinpoches, Jidzuman and Dhammukushos, and also the Venerable Sangha members, and all Dharma brothers and sisters. First of all, I would like to take this opportunity to extend my very warm welcome and very warm greetings to all of you. And then also I would like to thank you very much for giving us such a warm and traditional welcome upon our arrival here at the Sakya Monastery. As you know, originally my plan is to go to New York first, and then to last part of my trip is to come to Seattle. But then, as His Holiness Jigdha Dangzhen Rinpoche is not well, so I changed my plan, and I came straight from India to Seattle, and I'm very happy to be here, and especially to see the Sakya Trizin Rinpoche, who is not well, but at the same time we feel that he is kind of very stable and also feels better now, so which is very, very happy. And so while I'm here, since there's not much time, that we don't have any other programs except just to meet all the Dharma brothers and sisters and to have some teachings. And I decided to give this teaching by Chogyal Phagpa, Pakpa, as you know. Chogyal Phagpa Pakpa is one of the five great masters of the Sakya tradition, and he is a very, very great master. And I'm sure many of you are already familiar about his life stories and so no need to go into detail. He wrote many books. They are complete, I think, about four volumes. And they contain many, many precious teachings. And among them is this advice given to the prince of the Mongol emperors. The prince is called the Jibik Timur, is the name. And so this I find very practical and very precise and also very useful, especially for the general public, because it has three chapters. The first chapter is all about actually a worldly life, how to lead a worldly life according to the Dharma, and especially being a prince, how to rule the country in the Dharma ways. And then the second chapter is about the Hinayana teachings, because now, after all, the worldly life has no essence and it has no benefit, so one has to enter Dharma. And then to enter Dharma, then you first enter with the Hinayana teachings. Though there are many different kind of people, but generally speaking, then we go through the what we call the gradual path, which means that we begin from ordinary life to the Dharma life, from beginning from the very basic stage, which is the Hinayana path. And then the third chapter is about the Mahayana teachings. This one does not have the Mantrayana teachings because it is given for mainly focusing on the general people. And this is very long actually. It has also many commentaries. It has some very long commentaries also, but and it is very difficult to finish all of it in a short session. So what I'm going to do is just kind of summarize the main parts, especially emphasizing on the first chapter, because the first chapter is, as I said, is for the general ordinary people, general public, how to live a meaningful life, how to live a life according to the in a virtuous way. And so in the beginning he pays homage to the Buddha, because it is customary, and moreover, by paying to the Buddha, homage to the Buddha, that it has many benefits, that for himself, when he composed, that to be able to complete the teaching, and also in the future, that whoever reads, when he sees in the first line, that paying to the Buddha, homage to the Buddha, who possess the infinite wisdom, compassion, and the power, so that one gains a great merit, even just by hearing the name of the Buddha, or even just by paying the respect to the Buddha. And so therefore it has many, many benefits, so that's why he wrote this. And then secondly, he said that now you are the prince who has everything, who has a good race and good body and wealth, power and everything. So he kind of praises to the prince. And then thirdly, he said that he is giving this gift because being a prince who has plenty of wealth, so much wealth, there's no point giving material gifts. But if he gives a dharma gift, then that will be a great benefit. Just as like the ancient time, the great master Nagarjuna, who made the dharma gifts to his friend, the king. And so similarly, that he is also giving the these dharma gifts, which will benefit him very much. And then he talks about the glories of the worldly life, the glories of the dharma. The worldly life, even though how glorious it is, but if it lacks the spiritual, the practice of the spiritual glories, then it is just like eating a good food with a poison. Because eventually, the worldly life, eventually, all it creates is more sufferings and no real benefit. There are many stories about how the ancient kings that who have a great power and wealth, but then they engage so much negative deeds in their lives, so that in their life after their death, they will be falling down into the lower realms, where they will have a unimaginable amount of sufferings. And then also, even though you have the dharma glories, but if it lacks the worldly kind of glories, then again you cannot really benefit. It is just like a jewel, precious jewel that is wrapped in. If the precious jewel is wrapped in, then it could not shone its brightness or its shining, could not shine. So if you have both glories of the worldly life as well as the dharma life, then you could benefit the sentient beings. So therefore, since he already has the worldly glories, that if it is combines with the dharma glories, then he can really benefit, and that it will be a great happiness for this life, and also in the future, life also, that it is a great benefit. So therefore, that he is going to tell this great thing. And then the very first thing that he said, that is, when you are living a worldly life, he gives the advice of nine things, and the first one is that when you have wealth, power, and everything, then you tended to rise pride or what do you call the arrogant. So this is wrong. So the first thing is that one should not be proud. Even when you have everything, one should not have proud. But just by saying that you should not have a proud, you should not have arrogance, understand why we should not have. But then he gives the examples. He says that one should not have arrogance because everything is impermanent. Even the things that which we consider are very solid and permanent, such as the light of the sun and ocean, which is very wide and deep, and the Mount Sumeru, as you know, I'm sure you all make mandal offerings. So when you make the mandal offerings, in the center you have the Mount Sumeru. The Mount Sumeru is a essence of all the elements, and it is a huge and very solid and stable. Even these things also eventually going to disappear. The sun will also change, and the oceans will also change. Even the Mount Sumeru, which is very huge and stable and solid and hard, is also going to disappear. So we as an ordinary person, the living person, no matter how good race, how high race that one is born, how beautiful the one's body is, how many companions that you have, how glorious you have, how much power you have, how much education you have, how much knowledge you have, that it's all going to end one day. Nothing is impermanent. Everything is impermanent. The Buddha said that all compound things are impermanent, which means that anything that is created with the cause and condition is impermanent. If it is not something on the cause and condition, then it could be permanent. But there's nothing, no phenomena that is not depend on the cause and condition. As long as it needs depend on the cause and condition, then it could not be permanent. Everything is going to be permanent. So therefore, ancient time, there was one universal emperor called Sojongpa. He was very, very powerful, and he is a universal emperor, and he ruled the whole four continents. And not only that, then he even went to the heavenly realms, and he sits on the same throne as the Lord Indra. But even then, the human being's desire has no satisfaction. No matter how much you have, you don't have satisfaction. So therefore, he has no satisfaction. He wants more. He wanted to become the Lord of the heaven himself. And so due to this, then eventually he fall down from the heavenly realm to the ground, and he passed away. So likewise, that wherever you are, so one should not be proud or the arrogant, because all impound, all everything is impermanent. All compound things are impermanent, and all compound things are with the four endings. Four endings means the end of gathering is separation. Wherever we gather, in the beginning we gather together in the one place, but then eventually the end of that is we all go to separate, to go different directions. Even in like in what we think as like for a long time, our family members are all together. We think that all whole lifetime that we are together, but eventually that we also change. First the parents dies, then the oneself also dies, and so all goes different directions due to karma, that they were all born as a family, in one family. But then at the end, that all goes separate. So the end of gathering is separation. And the end of accumulation is exhaustion. No matter how much you accumulate, how much wealth, power, possessions that you accumulate, nothing remains forever. Eventually, it all exhausts. As we read in the history, the ancient time, the great empires, the great empires that ruled almost the whole world, they eventually extinct. They all end, they become small. And so the end of accumulation is exhaustion. And then the end of height is to fall down. No matter how high you reach in the heavenly realms where the gods that who remains in the worldly meditative state, they gain through the worldly meditation, they gain quite a high stage. But since they have not cut the root of the samsara, eventually again they fall down. Similarly, even in the human society, how high you reach the positions, the titles or whatever, how high you reach, but eventually it falls down. And the end of birth is death. Anyone who is born have to end with death. There's a nobody who is born but who didn't die. Everyone who is born has to die at the end. And there's not even the slightest doubt about this. You know, everyone who is born has to die. So therefore, there's no point of being proud or the arrogance. Even though your power, your wealth, your knowledge, you have everything, but one should not be proud. One should be very humble. It has qualities. So that is the number one. And then number two is the opposite. One should also should not be timid. You think that Now I'm ordinary people, I could not do anything, I will not be success, I will not be able to proceed further in the Dharma, I could not get liberations, I could not get enlightenment. This also, one should not be timid like this, because there are many more beings who are much worse than you, like three lower realms, hell realms, hungry ghost realms, animals realms, and moreover, after all, we all human beings are same. And the great bodhisattvas also, in the beginning, ordinary human beings like us, but they made efforts, and they made efforts so that eventually they succeed. So if we also, we should not be timid, we should not feel timid, we should not think of in a kind of negative way, we should be think in a positive way, that if we work also hard, we will be able to succeed. There's the story about seven worms who are sitting on the leaf. And then the leaf was floating over the lake. And in the center of the lake, there is a statue of Buddha. And then this somehow, accidentally, the wind blew and the leaf was going around and made the circumambulation of the Buddha statue seven times. Of course, worms don't want to know what is the Buddha, whether they are doing. It just happened due to their good karma, due to their good luck, that it just so happened that they went around seven times. So due to this merit, in their next life, they were born as seven daughters of human beings, but born in the low caste. So everybody sort of looked down them, and they feel very sad. They feel very sad because everybody is kind of treating them badly because being born in as a lower caste. Because in ancient time they have a lot about the races and the different races in India. I think mainly in India you have the Brahmins and then the royal race and then the business race and then the lower caste who do all the bad jobs like cleaning and so on. So ancient time this, and this of course affected many countries in Asia, including Tibet also. But according to the actually Buddhism, there's no race such as a race. Buddha said everyone, not only the human beings, but every living being possessed the Buddha nature. Because every living being possessed the Buddha nature, so that every living being has the opportunity to become a fully enlightened Buddha, if they meet the right methods. So that makes everyone equal. There's no difference between man or woman, or high race or the low race, intelligent or not, everyone is equal. It is I always say the Buddha is the one who makes everyone equal. So they were born as seven daughters, and they were very sad because everyone treated them very badly, and their job is to cut the grass. So they cut the grass, and whatever money they got, they offered to Arhat. And so due to this merit, in their next life, they were born as a seven princess. And then there they had the opportunity to meet the spiritual master, and they create the enlightenment mind, and eventually they become bodhisattvas, and they eventually they attain the enlightenment. So you know, starting from the worms, so even the worms, by just little virtues like going circumambulations, can create such a success story. So we as a human being, and we have the opportunity to practice Dharma, we have the opportunity to hear Dharma, to practice Dharma, so therefore we should not be timid, and we should think in a positive way. So that is the second advice. Then the third one is to repay the kindness to the people who have benefited you, people who have helped you, directly or indirectly, by knowing that their kindness, the benefit and the kindness they have given. So we must, such as like one's own parents, the father, mother, and also the grandparents. So by remembering their kindness, we should pay respect and help them, and fulfill their needs. And so, and by doing this, that we gain merit, and also it will set a kind of good example how the other people will also follow. If you do the right thing, you show to the people, and then the other people will also do the same way. So therefore, it will be a great not only for yourself, but also you are setting a very good example. So therefore, it is important to remember the kindness, the benefit you have gained. Nobody is born alone. You know, everybody, we have, when we were born, through the kindness of our parents, and friends and teachers and so on, that due to their kindness that we become a human being. If the baby is born and if the parents did not look after, the baby will die, and because baby cannot take care of he or herself, cannot eat, cannot talk, cannot do anything, but the parents did not let us die and taking care of, and so therefore that we become adults, and today that we enjoy the life, and we could also have the opportunity to follow the virtuous life or the spiritual path. I'm saying, not necessarily saying that one have to follow the Buddhist path. Buddhist path is the only path. I'm saying general spiritual path, because I believe that every major religions of the world has its own beauty and its own way to help the mankind. One, there's not one medicine that cures all the disease. You need the different medicines for different disease. So for certain people, Buddhism is more suitable. For certain people, Christianity is more suitable. For certain people, Hinduism is more suitable. So we must respect that every religion has its own roles, its own way to help the mankind. So therefore we should be very grateful to the people who have created such opportunity, because due to their kindness and due to their benefit that today we could follow the such path. And then the fourth one is that we must respect the leaders, like ancient time, the kings, because they lead the whole country, or even now, whatever, nowadays there's no kings, but they are kind of, I'm not saying necessarily the leader of the country, but wherever there are communities, that who leads the whole community, so that we must, someone who, where majority respect and majority think is a good leader, and then one should respect such being also. So therefore, then the whole work, whatever teamwork, could be successful. And then now the fifth one is to look after the inferior ones. And so this has many, several different parts. The first one is paying respect. We must respect the elderly persons. Among the races that we must respect the elderly persons. I'm sure you have seen the Tibetan paintings where there are elephant, monkey, and rabbit, and birds that are all on top of each other. They are like brothers because they respect the oldest one sits on the highest, and so they respect in this way. And they are very, they respect each other, and they remain very harmoniously, very unitedly, and so therefore it creates the whole country very peaceful. So like this, that we must respect. And then among the speakers, we must respect whoever tells the truth. The Buddha said, you see in India, ancient time in India, the Brahma, which means the priest, actually priest, the one who do all the temple works, who performs offerings, who do the service, who do the prayers, is the highest. Their priest race is considered the highest. But the Buddha said that by having hair or being born in the Brahmin race does not make oneself Brahma. But anyone who tells the truth, who is honest and who abstains from harming other beings is the Brahma. So likewise, that anyone who tells the truth, that we must respect. Among the teachings, there are many different kinds of teachings, but the teachings that is We must respect the teachings that is logical. The Buddha himself said, the followers of the Buddha should not take his teachings just mere faith, but one should take his teachings after careful analyzing it and after careful examining it. Just as like when we buy gold, we make sure that it is a genuine gold, and when you convince yourself that it is a genuine gold, then we will buy. Similarly, teachings also, one should not take just by being born in a Buddhist family, and then we just take the Buddha's teaching as out of faith. It's not right. First, we have to think very carefully, what is the meaning of the teaching? What is the benefit of practicing the teaching? What is the benefit of learning the teaching? What happens if we don't learn the teaching? What happens if we don't practice the teaching? And so like that. So that if we, any teachings that has the most this commentary has actually many other stories also, but it will be too long. So, and among the conducts that whoever benefit the people, whoever benefit people, that one should respect. And this is of course, obviously, the people who are very selfish, the people who are very self-centered, nobody respects them. Everybody thinks of badly about them. But the people who cares, general beings, of course, everybody admires them, isn't it? So therefore, anyone who, among the conducts, anyone who benefit the beings. Among the wealth, the best wealth is the knowledge. The material wealth, no matter how much you have, it could get lost, it could be stolen, it could be somebody can rob you. But the knowledge you gain through studies, knowledge you gain, nobody can take it away, nobody could steal it away. So the, among the wealth, the best wealth is the knowledge. And among the people, whoever has the education, the people who have a knowledge, they should be respect. And then among the inferiors, those who are poor, we must take care of them. We must have compassion. We must think of them. Among the poor, especially those who are sick, physically sick, that we must take care of them. And among the spouse, the one who follows you, one who agrees with you, who helps you, should respect. And among the children, that whoever holds the family lineage, that one should take care of them. And among the relatives, whoever did not betray you, who not deceit you, those relatives, even though some, one can have many relatives, but some relatives could deceit you, some relatives could do many other things, but one, those who don't deceive, don't trick you, the one should respect. And among the friends, that whoever benefit you, whoever gives you the most benefit, one should take care of you. And among the attendants, the whoever listens to you, who tells you, like olden time when Lord Buddha, when he left the kingdom, he sees the being in the kingdom, being in the king, has no essence, no benefit, and he wished to renounce. But it is not easy because his parents, his king, his father, and also everyone do not want him to leave the kingdom. So they have many bodyguards, and they have many protectors, many, many attendants, and so it is not easy to leave the kingdom. But there's a one servant who takes care of the Buddha's horse. He listens to Buddha. Buddha said, tonight that I'm going to leave the king palace, that you must ready to make my horse with the saddle and everything. And so he listens to so such attendance that one should take care of you. And and those who are among the benefit, who when you help them, that they who appreciate your help, those who appreciate your help, that one should take care of them. And those who are harming, those who could be patient, those people who get harmed but who are very patient, one should take care of them. And then among those who are coming, those who are traveling, especially the travelers. Of course, ancient time, there are no places to live as a modern time. So those who are travelers, especially those who come suddenly who are traveling, they should be taken care of. So he said those how to benefit these Chogyal Phagpa's text, which is known as Jewel Garland, has a commentary by the Jamgwe Amishab, who is one of the throne holders of the Sakya order, who is also a very great master and scholar. He wrote a long commentary, and in this commentary, one interesting thing about is that it mentions about many other religions other than Buddhist. Of course, Buddhism came from India, so in India there are Hinduism. Hinduism and Buddhism are kind of together. So the Buddhist texts, especially the philosophical texts, mentions about detailed philosophy about the Hinduism, because there are a lot of repeated, they have a lot of debates between the Buddhists and the Hinduism. There's a lot of interactions between Buddhists and Hinduism. So there's a lot of so much about Hindus, different Hindu schools, their views and their philosophy and their beliefs. But other than that, Buddhism is mainly in India, and then it went few countries in Asia. It's not so much traveled to the like Middle East or Europe or America or any other countries. So there's no kind of interrelations with other than Hinduism. There's not much interrelations with Buddhism. Buddhist text does not mention about other religions. But in this commentary, mentions very clearly about other religions, such as like Islam. And also, I think that this is the only text that mentions about the Christianity also. Because olden time, there's very little contact between the countries due to because there's no communication, also the transportations are very difficult, so there's very, very little known. Like the Buddhism is not known to the West or in the Middle East or other countries. And so similarly, the Jews and Christianity is philosophies, and their views are not mentioned in any of the Buddhists. But in this text, I was amazed to see that it mentions very clearly about the Christianity in this text. So therefore, it's very, very. And then it mentions about by doing this, paying respect and taking care of the downtrodden or the inferior ones, and then the benefit that you gain, he said. For example, like the fishermen and the butchers, etc., the people who harms life, who harms other beings' lives, they could not fulfill their own life also. They could not benefit. They could not fulfill their own purpose. So how could they, those people who engage in negative deeds, how could they benefit other beings? Because their nature of their work is such that they are always harming other people, like the fisherman, he always catches the fish, and the butchers that who always slaughters animals, and so they could not fulfill their own wish, their own life also. So how could they benefit the other beings? Whereas like Buddhas, the Bodhisattvas, and the Shravakas and the Pratyeka Buddhas, that who are abstain from harming other beings, and then always think about others, especially the bodhisattvas. Bodhisattvas who devote their whole life in to and their energy, devote their full energy to the benefit of the others. Then of course they gain great qualities, depending on how wide, for example, the Shravakas. Shravakas are mainly focusing on the one's own liberation, so therefore their scope is very small. And then Pratyeka Buddha is slightly bigger. The Bodhisattvas is huge, because Bodhisattvas, their motivation is to help all sentient beings without any limits. So the bodhisattvas, therefore, by doing, paying respect and looking after the impurious and poor ones, that one can get great benefit. And then he said that it is in the actually, I believe every religion, every different religion, explains some kind of the cause and effect or the law of karma. But in Buddhism, explains in the most detailed way. So the karmas that we created, and then we get the results. And this is the result, there are different results, what we call the ripening result, and the result that is similar to the cause, and the result of ownership. The result that is similar to the cause means that when you practice compassion and people, you gain respect. People who are brutal, who are angry, nobody respects them. But if you be kind and caring for the others, then people, you gain the respect. Then you help them, then you get worshipped. You explain them with the kind words and sweet speech, you get the praise, etc. So so this is what we call the result that is similar to the so the first one is not proud, second one is not to be timid, third one is to remember the kindness and to pay back the kindness and the benefit, and then fourth one is to respect the leaders or the rulers of the country, and fifth one is to look after the downtrodden and the inferior ones, and now the sixth one is because this advice is given to the prince who is going to be the ruler of the country. So therefore, he advised to expand the kingdom by being kind and by being helpful. Because the bigger the subjects, the bigger the you have, the greater, the more glorious the kingdom is. He gave the example, if you are skillful, then you will be able to expand the kingdom, one will be able to do the things. And so therefore you can expand, the more you have, the more benefit, the more glorious that one's kingdom is. Sixth one. And then the seventh one is to rule the country according to the Dharma. To rule the country that you according to the Dharma, and this has like he gave the example. When you rule the country, in the country there are many different kinds of people that who follows the rules, who listens to the orders of the kings, and those who don't listen and who do the wrong things. So those should be differentiate. And those who are really following the rules and doing the right things, they must be accepted and they must be looked after, they must be given the awards and they must be taken care of. And those who are not doing, those who are doing the wrong way, those who are doing the wrong things, they have to be punished. And punishment also has the way you give the punishment. He said it should be like when we treat the patients. When we treat the patients, we give them injections and we take the blood out, we also operate them. When you do this, we are not doing the patient to create pains or to harm him, to harm the patient. We are doing it to help him, to cure his disease. So by giving injection is painful, operation is also painful, taking blood is also painful, but it helps them. So by giving punishment also, not out of anger, not out of hatred, not just to hurt the person, but to help. So by giving this punishment, that he becomes a better person. He can be cured. And become a good person. And he completely opposed the capital punishment. He said it is wrong to kill the person. Because he gave the example, if the cloth is dirty, if you wash it, you can still use it. As a dirty cloth, you can't use, but if you wash it carefully, then you can still use it. But if you say cloth is dirty and if you burn it, then it is finished. You cannot use it anymore. Similarly, the person have to be treated. Person who are doing the wrong things, who are going against the law, who are doing the wrong things, they should be given the punishment according to their guilt. But that out of compassion, out of intention to help them. And those who are a good person, who are doing the right thing, they should be given the awards according to their works. That should also not be those who are doing the good things. Those who are working very hard, they should be given large awards, those who are medium and so on. Otherwise, it is just like giving the wrong foods to the different people. If a baby's food is given to the adult, it is not, the adult will not fulfill. Similarly, the adult person's food is given to the baby could not digest. So similarly, according to the works they have done, they should be treated. And then the eighth one is whatever wealth we have, we should do it carefully. And here he talks about the wealth also. Wealth, there are four kinds of wealth. One kind of wealth is like enemies. And one kind of wealth is like relatives. One kind of wealth is like waste, and one kind of is wealth is just general wealth. So the first one kind of wealth, first one is like enemies. When you acquire the wealth, you make a lot of difficulties, so you go through a lot of hardships. And then afterwards, after finding the wealth, it becomes the source of fighting, even among the relatives and so on. And so eventually even some people lose their life also for the sake of wealth. So such wealth is like enemies. And another kind of wealth is like relatives. It's those who have good karma, and that they can find the wealth without much difficulties. And then whatever they gain, they make offerings, they also give to the other people, they also use your own way, so that it benefits everybody, just like the kind relatives, that it is very helpful. And then another kind of wealth is just wasted, that you are so stingy that you can't use for yourself, you can't make offerings, you can't give to the poor ones, you just accumulate and accumulate and accumulate, and then one day it will be used by somebody else. Just like the bees. The bees collect a lot of honey and they could not use it, but one day the man takes the honey. And then the fourth kind is just as wealth, just using to one's own relatives and oneself. So there are four kind of wealth. And then the ninth one is whatever we do, one have to do it very carefully. Everything that one should do it very whatever works that we undertake, we should first think very carefully and discuss with the friends, and then do the work. It is a wise way to do things. Is before you do, that you must think and discuss and then do it. You do the work first and think later is the fool's way of doing it. So in this way, these are the nine things that he advised how to live an ordinary person's life according to the Dharma or the virtuous ways. So this is the very brief outline of the first chapter. And then second chapter is about the Hinayana teachings. Mainly it tells about this, because here he talks a lot about other religions also, but among the other religions, then Buddhism, of course, and then the Hinayana begins by taking refuge, because taking refuge is the very first step that you take when you begin the Dharma path. Take the Dharma path, that we have the three jewels, the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. And this in according to the reality also, because if you need to go to elsewhere, if you need to go to an unknown country, first thing you require is someone who can show you the path, the correct path. And so that is the Buddha. So we take refuge in the Buddha as our guide, because the Buddha shows the path. And then secondly, we take refuge in the Dharma as our actual path. It is not enough just to having a guide, good guide, but as the guide shows you the path, you have to follow, you have to work yourself. Either you ride on the car, or walk, or ride on the horse, or like that, you have to begin your journey. You have to take your journey. Otherwise, just by having a guide, you will not get to the destination. So you have to. So the Dharma is the main savior of you. So we have to practice Dharma. What Buddha has given, the liberation and the enlightenment could not win without efforts. And also, there are many different religions, of course, there are many religions believe the creator. Everything is created by the God or the deity. But the Buddhism, there is no creator. Everything is our own karma. So just by praying to the Buddha that we could not get the enlightenment, you could not get the liberation. Liberation, the Buddha could not give liberation as a gift, but we have to earn the liberation by working ourselves, by studying Dharma, by contemplation and meditation and practicing it, so making ourselves, our own defilements, negative emotions must be purified, and our basic qualities, the loving-kindness, the compassion, and tolerance, etc., you have to improve, and eventually then we can attain the liberation. So the Dharma is the actual path. Then when you take such a journey, instead of traveling by yourself alone, that if you have trusted companions, then it is very helpful. So therefore we take refuge in the Sangha as our companions. So it tells mainly about the refuge. And then the third chapter is very long actually, but it has all the bodhisattvas. And the bodhisattvas, the main difference between the Hinayana and Mahayana is the creating the enlightenment mind. Creating the enlightenment mind means you realize samsara is full of suffering. We need to renounce completely from the suffering of samsara, and we must attain the liberation, because nobody wants sufferings. Whether you are believer or non-believer, whether you are Buddhist or non-Buddhist, everyone wishes to be free from suffering, and everyone wishes to accomplish happiness. And then you realize that we believe in rebirth. This is not the only life that we have. We had innumerable lives before, and we also have innumerable lives in the future until we attain the liberation or the enlightenment. And so therefore, every time that we are born, we are born in different country, different family. So in this way that we are rotating, we are going through all different in circles. This is called the circle of life, the wheel of life. Just like wheel, the wheel turns one round, and then again it turns in another round. So like that, the life goes on. This life ends, then another life begins. So therefore it's like a wheel of life. So therefore, every sentient being is actually our mother. Every sentient being is our father. Every sentient being is our relatives. So by abandoning them and just to seek liberation for oneself alone is not right. Even in ordinary sense, if your most loved person is left in a very difficult place and yourself in a safe and happy place, if you are a good-hearted person, you wouldn't feel happy. You would rather go to the place where the one's loved ones are and try to help them. So likewise, that we could not abandon sentient beings, including our enemies. Our most hated enemies are also our most kind mothers and fathers and so on. Just due to the change of life that we do not recognize each other, and we see some as enemies, some as friends, some as relatives, some as indifferent. But in reality, every sentient being, irrespective of whether it is a known ones or unknown ones or everyone, so therefore abandoning them and just to seek liberation yourself is not right. So therefore, you need to help them. But how can we help them? We are ordinary persons. We do not have the ability, we do not have the knowledge, we do not have the power. So how can we help them? The only way to help them is to attain the enlightenment. Because once you attain the enlightenment, then even in a single moment, you can rescue countless sentient beings. And so therefore, you wish to attain the full enlightenment for the sake of all sentient beings is called creating the enlightenment mind. And so when you create the enlightenment mind, then you are in the Mahayana path. You are a Buddha's child. You are Buddha's child in the sense that you hold the Buddha's lineage, that eventually that you are sure to attain the Buddha. So therefore you hold the Buddha's race. So that is the Mahayana. And then of course it has many other practices such as like the six paramitas and four collecting things, and then the path like ten bhumis or the 10 stages of the bodhisattvas, and then ultimately attain the enlightenment. According to the Mahayana, there are only 10 bhumis. And 11th bhumi is the Buddhahood. There are 5 paths. Path of accumulation, path of application, path of seeing, path of meditation, path of no more learning. Path of accumulation and path of application are known as a worldly path, because we are still worldly when we can achieve these paths. Path of accumulation means to accumulate the merits. In the beginning, we just create a lot of merits. So that is the path of accumulation. Path of application is that you improve, you go on one step forward, and that you are nearer to the beyond worldly level, the beyond worldly level. And then the path of seeing is the first bhumi. Path of seeing is that when you see the ultimate truth, then you reach the beyond worldly level. And then the path of meditation is the remaining 9 bhumis. From second bhumi onwards, that it improves. Path of seeing is just like seeing the first moon. The Buddhahood is like a full moon. So you see the one portion of the ultimate enlightenment. So therefore, it is known as path of seeing. And then part of meditation is you further increase, just like the moon increases. Likewise, that your knowledge and your realization increases up to the 10th bhumi. And then the 11th bhumi is the Buddhahood, where it is like a full moon. So these are, of course, in great detail. There's no time to explain in a short session. And so with this, I conclude today's teaching. So whatever that I talk, lately my English is also not kind of out of practice a little bit, so my English is not so good, not so fluent. And but whatever I presented, I hope that it will have some benefit to you. And since here you have a very beautiful monastery, and you have a good teacher, and a good great lama like Daksen Rinpoche, and a good teacher like Khenpo and Tugula and Khenpola and all the Daksen Rinpoches, and so therefore you have all the opportunity and necessary facilities, so that you must continue to practice, and sure eventually that you will make a great realization. So once again, thank you very much, everyone.
Go to His Holiness long life, pray for all of
Yawa Jesus.
Jinpa Padin Saji Jizu Pambani Nichon Zoli Zibi Yende Jin Chayu Zuzun Doji Tadin Su Lumi Lama Joy Zoy Tuji Da Yodon Den Sun Jan Zin Todo Da Jami Den Bindi Chuta So Vindin De Rujo Jin Padin Jo Padamba yodinamba Padanzo shivoidamba Nakozi janze Enjulujim padalami kutsidamba Tanganyayala deshinjowa Tandajimali tsozai dushan Ninyodoy sanji salangambashoy Shantzawadam chujinshapa Tajiso yara kushiso wa Yege wa chonsin dake chasa Patanchi zubi shanchu chenpo
Okay, this is all done for this event, so His Holiness Sakya Trizin will be taking a break, and then the next event will be the Tibetan Association of Washington talk, and so the rest of us can go downstairs and then re-enter the shrine room a few minutes before the talk begins. Thank you.